For this video, we'll be describing how changes in volume and pressure can be predicted to determine the direction of shift in equilibrium. So remember, from first semester chemistry, we do have an inverse relationship. As we increase the pressure on a system, its volume will decrease, as illustrated by the image at the bottom here. So notice, as we're increasing the pressure on this lid, we end up decreasing the volume of the container. Now, when we're making changes in volume or pressure, we need to examine the moles of gas on each side of an equation. So realize that volume will affect pressure, or we can directly affect pressure, but that will only affect the gases in a reaction. For me personally, it's easier to think in terms of volume because it's so much more visual and easier for me to picture what's happening. And so realize that if we increase the volume of a container, a reaction will have more space to be able to take up or have more molecules present. And so if we increase the volume of a container, we'll see that our reaction is going to shift to the side of the reaction that has more moles of gas. And again, it's only the gases that are affected. So if I have solid, liquid, or aqueous in a reaction, those substances will not be affected by shifts or changes in volume or pressure. And of course, if we decrease volume, our reaction is going to shift to the side with fewer moles of gas. Again, just the gases that are affected. Realize, of course, also that an increase in volume is the same as a decrease in pressure. So both of these questions would have the same shift, and a decrease in volume would be the same as an increase in pressure. So specifically looking at our equation of N2O4 decomposing into 2NO2, if I increase the volume for this container, again, that's the same as decreasing pressure. Increasing volume, realize that I have 1 mole of reactant gas and 2 moles of product gas. And so if I were to make these changes, however it's described, increasing volume or decreasing pressure, this specific reaction will shift to the right because I have more moles of gas on the product side. So to determine directions of shift for these, we have to look at each reaction individually. For this one, pretend the answers are not on this slide. Forgot to erase them. But two scenarios that we want to work through. If I have this first reaction, I have hydrogen with chlorine combining to make 2HCl. Again, we need to compare how many moles of gas we have on each side. Realize on our reactant side, we have 2 moles, and on our product side, we have 2 moles. So this is one scenario where for this given reaction, looking at volume and pressure changes, there would be no change or no shift in the equilibrium. Because I have the exact same number of moles on both sides, neither side has more moles, and so there would be no shift. So this is one example where you could have no shift in equilibrium. For the second example down here, notice that we have a carbon solid listed in our equation. Everything else is gases, but this solid is not going to be affected by changes in volume or pressure. And so for all intents and purposes, for this reaction, I only have 1 mole of a reactant gas, and I have 2 moles of product gas. So for this one, if I decrease my volume, I'm going to shift to the side with fewer moles. That would be to the left. If pressure is decreased, this is the same as increasing volume, meaning I'm going to shift to the side with more moles, and that would be my product side to the right. So again, for volume and pressure, we have to look at each reaction individually, comparing moles of gas from the coefficients on each side. The last two changes that are rather silly but are always included are what happens when we add a catalyst and what happens when we add an inert gas to a system. One of the key things to recognize is with Le Chatelier's principle, we're describing systems that are already at equilibrium and then we cause a stress. So remember that when we add a catalyst, it speeds up a reaction, but it speeds up a reaction getting to equilibrium. If I have a system that's already at equilibrium, adding a catalyst isn't going to do anything. And so I don't know why you would, but if your system is already at equilibrium, adding a catalyst will have no effect on the equilibrium. In fact, it's not going to change anything about the reaction because it has already finished reacting. Same idea with adding an inert gas. So by inert gas, we mean typically our noble gases or a gas that won't react with anything. So noble gases are the most common, right? Your helium, your neon, krypton, argon, etc. Well, they're called inert gases because they don't react. So if I add an inert gas and it doesn't react with anything, it's going to have no effect on my equilibrium. So adding a catalyst and an inert gas, these would be other examples where we would see no shift in equilibrium. This slide that's in your notes is a great summary of everything. So it summarizes your changes in concentrations, temperatures, and volume and pressure. For this slide, we're going to go through and practice with these changes. Again, I'll ask you to pause the video and come up with your answers for each one of the changes listed down here. When you have your answers, replay the video and I'll go over them. Okay, I'm assuming you have your answers. So again, we're looking at this equation. Notice that we are given our enthalpy here, and we're only going to use that for temperature. And our first question is temperature. So here we're increasing temperature. And what we need to know with our enthalpy, since this is positive, that tells us it's endothermic, and that means that we are going to view heat as a reactant. So I'm literally going to write heat on the reactant side here. If temperature is increased, now that I have heat as a reactant, that is going to cause this reaction to shift to the right. For volume increasing, this is where I want to look at how many moles of gas I have on each side. Realize on our reactant side, we have a total of 4. And on our product side, we have a total of 5. So when I increase volume, it's going to shift to the side with more moles of gas. That would be to the right. When pressure is increased, this is the same as decreasing volume. That would be to the opposite side as our previous one. So this would be to the left. HCl being added. So this is the same as a change in concentration. I'm increasing the amount of a product. The reaction wants to undo that, so it's going to shift away from products back toward reactants. Adding a catalyst, we know there's no change or shift, however you want to phrase that. If we add Cl2, recognize that Cl2 is on the reactant side. So if I add a reactant, that's going to cause my reaction to want to use that up, shift toward the products. And if I remove H2O, H2O is a reactant. So I'm removing a reactant. The system wants to undo that stress. It's going to shift back to the left to replace that reactant. All right, that concludes our discussion on Le Chatelier's principle.